Greetings, students, and welcome to this lesson on egoism and the social contract theory. We're going to talk about what it means to do ethics in a world that may be potentially filled with selfish and self-interested and evil people. So let's get started. I start with a question here. What would you do if tonight were like a purge sort of situation? Imagine it. Tonight you can do anything you want and there would be no punishment. You would not get in trouble. There would be no judgment. No one would form judgments about you or think less of you. There would be no consequences, right? You'll never get caught. Anything at all is legal and anything is possible. Now, not the logically impossible, but anything is possible within the realm of logical possibility. What would you do? What would most of us do? Your answer to this will perhaps betray your philosophy of human nature. Let me explain. In Plato's The Republic, it's one of the great works of political philosophy in the history of Western philosophy. In his book, The Republic, in book two of that book, he describes a shepherd who finds a golden ring. And basically he goes into this cave, there's a dead body there, and he finds a golden ring and he takes the ring. Obviously the corpse is not going to need it, so he takes the ring and he uses it, and he realizes later that it makes him actually invisible. And so he tests its powers a few times and discovers that the ring works. Now, if you're thinking this is like the Lord of the Rings, you're absolutely correct. J.R.R. Tolkien certainly knew about Plato's Republic and put into the Lord of the Rings, this old story from Plato's Republic. So what does the guy do? Well, he goes to town. He kills the king. He captures the throne. He now becomes the king. He marries the queen. And basically, when he's invisible, he satisfies every want or desire that he had. He exercises all of his depraved and, you could argue animalistic wants. He does that. And this is the question we're faced with when talking about egoism and the social contract. Are we like that? Is that who we are? Here's what Plato says, quote, "No man can be imagined to be of such an iron nature that he would stand fast in justice." In other words, if you got the ring yourself, you know, no man can be expected to not devolve into such animalistic urges. No man could stand fast in justice. No man would keep his hands off what was not his own when he could safely take what he liked out of the market, or go into houses and lie with anyone at pleasure, or kill or release from prison whom he would, and in all respects be a god among men. If you could imagine anyone obtaining this power of becoming invisible and never doing anything wrong or touching what was another's, he would be thought by the onlookers to be a most wretched idiot, right? He'd be an idiot not to take advantage of those powers. Although they would praise him to one another's faces and keep up appearances with one another from a fear that they too might suffer injustice. And Plato basically says, enough of this. Enough of this. That's the question we're going to deal with in this lesson on egoism and the social contract theory. What if it is the case that we truly are selfish? What if we truly are evil at heart? Egoism is the first theory we're going to talk about, and that basically says you are evil, you are self-interested, and accept it. And then we'll talk about the opposite of egoism, which is altruism. Then we'll go over examples of egoism and then the arguments for and against it. When we talk about the social contract theory, I'm going to give you another sort of what would you do if scenario, and then we'll talk about Thomas Hobbes and his understanding of the social contract and basically why it exists. Then we'll discuss a problem for the social contract theorist that kind of illustrates why the social contract is helpful. And then we'll discuss advantages and disadvantages of the social contract theory. All right, egoism. First, on the most basic level, what do you notice about the word itself? Egoism. Well, basically, you can see that it has the word ego right there in the title. And so what do you think we're going to be talking about? Well, it's something to do with the self. It's something to do with a philosophy of the self. As we've already mentioned, egoism is the philosophy of selfishness. And there are different kinds of egoism: ethical egoism and psychological egoism. Ethical egoism is rooted in psychological egoism. So let's talk about what these both mean. Well, psychological egoism suggests that each person does in fact pursue his or her own self-interest alone. That you have no real option to be selfless. That you do in fact pursue what's good for you and only good for you. Ethical egoism goes a step further and says not only do you, but you should pursue your own self-interest exclusively. Now, the difference between the two is what? Well, one says what you do and the other says you should do it. In ethics, you could ask yourself, how does egoism fit here? You can see probably why egoism is problematic, because throughout this whole class, we're talking about using our minds and trying to do things for the good of others. Egoism comes on the scene and suggests, no, you should do what's good for you. So, if you were going to take notes on any one slide, it would probably be this one. Egoism is the morality of selfishness. And our only duty, according to an egoist, is to do what's in our own best interest. Do what's best for ourselves. Other people, you know, the other theories talk about taking care of others. Other people matter only insofar as they can benefit us from an egoist perspective. Ayn Rand is the person you should associate with this theory. And she says this, quote, "The achievement of his own happiness is man's highest moral purpose." She went so far as to say selfishness is not only something you should avoid, it's something you should embrace. It is, in fact, she says, a virtue. She has a book called The Virtue of Selfishness. That's egoism, plain and simple. Now, the opposite of egoism is a word called altruism, and this is the belief in and practice of selfless concern for others. According to an egoist, this actually doesn't really exist, right? So what do we do about these observable facts? There are times when people do favors for other people, these random acts of kindness, without even seeming to consider the impact on themselves. The top picture up there is Michael Bloomberg, the former mayor of New York City, giving an award and thanking this gentleman right here who dove into a subway to protect someone from an oncoming subway car. He did it without any hesitation, and he did it without any concern for his own safety. He held someone down as a subway car went over top of them, and he ended up saving someone's life. Why did he do that? Was that selfishly motivated? The egoist would say, yeah, it actually was. It might seem like it's altruistic. It might seem like it is doing it for other people. But in reality, the egoist, especially the psychological egoist, is going to say, you always do what you want to do. You always do what makes you feel good. Right? Ayn Rand, as I mentioned, is the person you should associate with this theory. She says, if you tell humans that they have to do things for others, as the doctrine of altruism would suggest, then man is a sacrificial animal. Instead, she thinks we should have self-respect. We should have self-esteem. We should view ourselves as separate from the animals, able to pursue our own interests without having to worry about what's good for other people. And think about it. I want you to understand the logic of this. If everyone was practicing their own form of egoism, maybe everyone would take care of themselves and we wouldn't need to take care of each other. That's kind of her logic there. That's the way to view humans as unique, as special, as rational, as full of motivation to go out and pursue their own aims. So that's altruism. And the egoist would say altruism is a fiction. It does not exist. Because ultimately, when you peel away all of the layers of motivation, at heart is a desire to do what's in your own best interest. All right, so what are these arguments for egoism? Well, first of all, you could argue that altruism interferes in the lives of others. You are basically getting involved in situations when you shouldn't. Let me give you an example. Ethical egoists often point to the welfare state as an example of something that is bad. Taxes as an example of something that is bad. You're interfering in the lives of others. And this is basically the old saying, if you want to help someone, don't give them a fish, but rather teach them to fish. If you keep handing people things, if you keep giving people things, it is ultimately going to result in them not learning to do it for themselves. You're interfering in the lives of others. This is the major problem with communist governmental systems, right? This idea that to each according to his need, from each according to his ability, which was central to Marx's Communist Manifesto, you're interfering in the lives of others, this would argue, and you're ultimately not teaching them to fend for themselves. You're interfering. Second, you could argue that altruism leads to a denial of the self. If I give you stuff, if I bestow a bunch of gifts on you, if I solve all your problems for you, I'm not treating you with the respect that you deserve. I'm treating you as if you need my help. And yet, if I were to treat you as a full human being, the egoist would say, I would leave you alone. Trust that you are human enough, woman enough, man enough to take care of yourself. But when I offer you my help, I am basically denying your personhood, denying yourself. If we're each individually valuable, why not be selfish? Now, can you think of replies to these arguments for egoism? We'll discuss them in a second. Another argument for egoism is that some people think it is compatible with common sense morality. It basically leads to the golden rule. You wouldn't want someone interfering with the things that you're working on. You wouldn't want someone coming along and telling you that your ambitions, that your projects, that your goals and aspirations are stupid and you need to instead serve someone else. You want to chase your own dreams, right? Egoism, it is said by egoists, is compatible with that sort of common sense golden rule morality, or so it is argued by egoists. Let me give you an American example from who is perhaps the greatest president we've had, one of them certainly, Abraham Lincoln. In the 1800s, this was a story in a newspaper. Quote, Abraham Lincoln once remarked to a fellow passenger on an old-time mud wagon coach that all men were prompted by selfishness in doing good or evil. His fellow passenger was antagonizing his position when they were passing over a bridge. As they crossed this bridge, an old farmer was yelling terribly because his pigs had gotten into the water and were in danger of drowning. As the old coach began to climb the hillside, Mr. Lincoln called out, "Driver, can't you stop just a moment?" Mr. Lincoln jumped out, ran back, and began to lift the little pigs out of the mud and water and place them on the bank. When he returned, his fellow passenger remarked, "Now, Abe, where does selfishness come in this little episode?" "Why, bless your soul, Ed," Lincoln said. "That was the very essence of selfishness. I would have no peace of mind all day had I gone on and left that suffering old farmer worrying over those pigs. I did it to get peace of mind, don't you see?" Now, this is a telling example, because anytime we do something for others, why are we really doing it? Are we doing it for our own peace of mind? Because we like to be the kind of people who help? Maybe it's not as selfless as we thought. That's at least what the egoist would suggest to us. So what do you think? What are the real motives behind good deeds? As you think about that, let me tell you another story. Andrew Flossdorf, he was the National Spelling Bee champion in 1983, and he won by spelling this word right here, echolalia. As he stood up there, I'm sure he asked for the language of origin. I'm sure he asked to, for the word to be used in a sentence. He said the following. He said, echolalia. ECHOLELIA, echolalia. The thing is, all three judges misheard Mr. Flossdorf. They all misheard him and thought that instead of that first A, or instead of the E, that he had said the A. They misheard him and thought he spelled it correctly. It was only later that he found out that he actually spelled the word incorrectly, and he had a crisis of conscience. He wasn't very old. I think he was like 13 years old, and he had a crisis of conscience. He was labeled a hero, right? But why did he do it? Well, I don't think you could see it in an article this small, but if you want to look up this article, you will see he did it because he, quote, didn't want to feel like a slime. He did it to make himself feel better. Is this why we do all good actions? Is this why he, you know, said the thing he said, saying, I really didn't spell that word correctly. You shouldn't give me the trophy and the prize money. If the egoist is right, then that's exactly why he did it, because he wanted to feel a certain way. And if he had not acted with integrity, he would not have felt that way. He would have felt like it was given to him erroneously. All right, so now let's talk about the arguments against egoism, and then we'll take a break and then come back and talk about social contract theory. One argument against egoism is that egoism has the potential to endorse all sorts of wicked and terrible and evil behavior. What if someone would benefit by doing a horrible action against someone else? There are many examples, but here you could talk about murder, you could talk about sexual assault, you could talk about any of that. Egoism could potentially endorse that kind of wickedness, right? If people should do what's in their own self-interest, and if they believe their own self-interest leads them to take advantage of other people, to kill other people, egoism has a real hard time defending against that sort of evil and wickedness. You could also argue egoism is logically inconsistent. What happens, for example, when two people's self-interests collide? The example for this is the United States War on Terror in the early 21st century. The United States went to war with Iraq, and imagine you're an Iraqi citizen and all of a sudden bombs start raining down on you in March of 2003. Well, do you have a right to defend yourself using violence? Well, probably. That's in your own self-interest, and all of us would say, you know, we can defend ourselves when we're attacked. And yet the United States felt like they were justified because they were removing a threat. And so if egoism is true, both of these people fighting at opposite ends of a disagreement are both right, and that's logically inconsistent. Third, you could argue that egoism is unacceptably arbitrary. How does someone decide that one person's self-interest is more important than another's? We can give many examples here, like discrimination in all its forms, whether it's classist, racist, sexist, etc. So these are some arguments against egoism. And there are also some other general problems that we can mention. The first has to do with rational deliberation. As humans, we can decide what we're going to do. We can decide what is the right thing to do based on certain principles, like it's wrong to kill someone else unless there is like an overwhelming reason that justifies it, right? We can decide based on certain principles. We're not left to our emotions or our selfishness. We can decide to be selfless sometimes. And we sometimes do things because we ought to do them, not because we want to do them. And I'm reminded of a story when my own grandmother needed to move apartments, and I had to go to her storage unit, unpack it, and give her a bunch of things she needed from the 1950s and replace it with a bunch of other things from the 1950s. And it was not actually a pleasant day, but I did it because I ought to do them. I ought to help family members move, not because I want to help family members move. So rational deliberation is part of this. Another general problem has to do with mixed motives. Someone can have selfish and unselfish motives happening at the same exact time. And maybe good feelings are not the purpose of doing certain things, but they're just a byproduct. They're not the primary goal of helping other people. You don't help your grandmother move because of the good feelings you'll get. In fact, if your experience is anything like mine, you probably won't have good feelings about it. But that motive, the good feelings come after you do the right thing. You know, good feelings can be a byproduct, not the primary goal. All right, so here's the review before we take a break, and then we'll talk about the social contract theory. Psychological egoism suggests that people do, in fact, do what's in their own best interest. They are self-interested. They are selfish. Ethical egoism goes a step further to say people should do what's in their own interest. Altruism, according to the egoist, is not possible. It's selfless concern for others. The arguments for egoism were these three mainly. Altruism is self-defeating. It leads to a denial of the self, and egoism is basically compatible with common sense morality. And the arguments against egoism that we talked about, the most serious one is probably that egoism could endorse all sorts of bad behavior and wickedness. It's logically inconsistent, and it can be arbitrary. All right, so this ends part one of this video, of this lesson on egoism and social contract. If you have any questions or comments, let me know, and we will pick it up with part two.